Germany invaded Poland on September 1, 1939, and little did the world know that this was the start of World War II and the Holocaust. Gerda Weissman lived in Bielsko, Poland, and only a few days after Germany invaded Poland, Gerda's town was under the German authority. Gerda was Jewish, and she would soon find that her life would never be the same again. With her determination, Gerda was able to overcome the tragedy of the Holocaust, and out of the tragedy, a triumph was born. This is the Holocaust through her eyes.
After the end of World War I, Germany was in a state of depression. The Jewish people were blamed for this, which instilled hatred and mistreatment towards them. Adolf Hitler supported the idea that Jews were inferior, that they did not deserve the rights civilians received. When Hitler proclaimed himself Führer of Germany in 1933, after the death of Paul von Hindenburg, he took it upon himself to bring utmost destruction to the Jews. This is what initiated the Holocaust.
In August of 1939, 15-year-old Gerda was on her way home from vacation because her father, Julius, had suffered a mild heart attack. When they arrived home, they were met by many Jews trying to leave Poland because of the impending doom of the Nazis. Gerda's uncle sent them a cable that read, "Poland's last hour has come. Dangerous for Jews to remain. Your visa is waiting at Warsaw Embassy. Urge you to come immediately." But because of her father's health condition, he could not travel. He told Gerda and her older brother Arthur to go, but they refused, for they wanted their family to stick together. In 18 short days, Germany had conquered Poland. Bielsko had once been a peaceful city, but now it was anything but peaceful under the Nazi rule.
On October 18th, Arthur was recruited to go reconstruct the buildings the Nazis had destroyed in their invasion of Poland. The next day, Arthur was forced to leave. Gerda said goodbye to him, and when Arthur disappeared out of sight, that was the last time Gerda ever saw him. Before Christmas of 1941, Gerda's family sold all their possessions. They now lived in the basement of their home because the ethnic Germans got to move into upstairs of the displaced Jewish people's homes.
After Christmas in 1941, Jews were given ration cards and patches with the word Jew on it that went on the arm of their coats. On April 19, 1942, Jews in Bielsko were moved near the railway station outside of town. This was the newly established Bielsko ghetto. Gerda's last birthday with her parents was celebrated there. Her parents gave her an orange, which cost her mother a ring to obtain. A few weeks later, a notice was posted that everyone capable had to register for work. Gerda and her parents registered. Her father was sent to work and eventually live at the labor camp in Suhau, Poland, fortifying the river. Gerda and her mother were assigned to sewing military uniforms, but soon they were sent away to separate labor camps. June 27th, the night before Gerda's father was to leave, he made Gerda promise him to wear her ski boots when she went to work. She said, "Ski boots in June?" But she promised him, and this promise would later save Gerda's life. Throughout the Holocaust, Gerda carried pictures of her family in those boots.
When Gerda and her mother were sent away to work, they were assembled in two groups, one group of older women and another of younger women. Then they were placed in two trucks, one for each group. Gerda jumped out of the truck, trying to get to her mother. But a man named Marin picked her up and put her back, saying, "You are too young to die." The last words Gerda's mother ever said to her were, "Be strong." The truck took them to Sosnowitz, a labor camp, where Gerda worked laying bricks at a quarry. But they were not there long because they were transferred to another camp by train. On the train with Gerda was her close friend Ilse. Gerda told herself, "I am going to live."
The train pulled into the Bolkenhain station. Gerda and the women got off the train and were met by the leader of the Bolkenhain labor camp, Frau Kugler. Frau Kugler, barking orders, seemed to be a harsh woman, but she would prove to be otherwise. Bolkenhain was a new weaving camp. While there, Gerda fell ill, and her finger and toenails became infected. It was then that there was an inspection, and a harsh appearing Frau Kugler saved Gerda's life by rushing her to the looms. She forced Gerda to work, which spared her from being sent to Auschwitz because of her condition.
In August of 1943, Gerda and the women of Bolkenhain were divided into three groups to the span Bolkenhain. The women were sent to labor camps Landshut or Marsdorf. Gerda, along with her friend Ilse, were sent to Marsdorf. When they arrived at Marsdorf, it was evident that this was not like Bolkenhain. Here, Gerda was beaten by a guard while working. The first few days, she worked laying bricks, oiling, and cleaning machinery parts. Gerda only worked there for a few days, for she was reassigned to flax detail. Gerda and the other women moved flax from a freight car down a human chain until it reached a barn, where they stacked it. Flax was prickly and dusty, and it got in the women's eyes, lungs, and wounds. At night, a few women with Gerda had to unload coal from a freight car. Gerda could not take the backbreaking work of flax detail and coal much longer. But mercifully, she was spared, along with Ilse and a few others, to go weave at Landshut.
Conditions at Landshut were much better than they were at Marsdorf because Frau Kugler was there. Gerda was not at Landshut long, for it was disbanded. They were moved to a camp named Grunberg, where there were around 1,000 women living there. At Grunberg, Gerda worked on a spinning machine, but was soon reassigned to the much better job of recording information on the products being made at Grunberg. On January 29, 1945, a death march began because the Nazis were trying to hide the evidence of their crimes. There were more than 2,000 women from various labor camps in the death march, which started at Grunberg, Poland. Gerda knew that the death march was the first step to the end of the road, either to liberation or to doom. The death march was cold, and there was starvation and death. Gerda saw women breaking off their toes like twigs because they only had sandals on their feet, and she was grateful that her father had made her wear her ski boots.
6 weeks into the death march, there were about 400 women left alive. Gerda stayed alive by using her imagination and thinking about parties and dresses. It helped her escape the horror that she was experiencing. Else, Gerda's dearest friend, died on April 28th. Shortly before her death, she said to Gerda, "I am angry at no one, and I hope that nobody is angry at me. If my parents survive, don't tell them how I died." The death march ended on May 7, 1945, in Volary, Czechoslovakia. The death march had been over 300 miles long. Gerda was one of the 120 women who survived the death march. Gerda weighed 68 pounds, she had not bathed in 3 years, and her hair had turned white. The women were liberated by American soldiers. One soldier, Kurt Klein, was a Jewish man who had fled from Germany in 1933, moving to the United States and returning to Germany as an American soldier. He was Gerda's future husband. Kurt's parents had not been able to flee Germany with him, and they died at Auschwitz. Kurt gave Gerda the first piece of humanity that she had been shown in years.
"He opened the door and allowed me to precede him. He opened the door to my future." The day after liberation, May 8th, was Victory in Europe Day, and it was Gerda's 21st birthday. Of all Gerda's family and friends, she is the only one who survived the Holocaust. In June of 1946, Gerda and Kurt were married in Paris, and they moved to Buffalo, New York that same year. In 1957, Gerda published All But My Life, her memoir on the tribulation she faced during the Holocaust. In 1995, a documentary on Gerda's life, One Survivor Remembers, was released, and it won the Academy Award for Documentary Short Subject in 1996.
"In my mind's eye, I see those years and days, and those who never lived to see the magic of a boring evening at home. On their behalf, I wish to thank you for honoring their memory. And you cannot do it in any better way than when you return to your homes tonight to realize that each of you who know the joy of freedom are winners."
Recently, Gerda speaks around the country about her trials during the Holocaust and of hope, survival, acceptance in the world, and to educate people about the past so the Holocaust will never happen again. In 2008, she founded Citizenship Counts, a group that teaches tolerance and empathy. Her message, hatred and tyranny are not over. On November 17, 2010, President Barack Obama awarded Gerda the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the highest honor a civilian can receive. The Holocaust was a tragedy of persecuting and killing 6 million Jews, along with others for ethnic, national, and racial reasons. During the long, bitter years of slavery, through the dark, lonely, freezing nights and hungry days, we ask the question, will anyone ever understand? Will anyone care? Gerda survived those tragic years. Gerda is a survivor, making her story a triumph.